If you're new to Airtable or tools like it, you are going to love this video because I'm going to help break down for you here the three key tips that everyone should have when starting out in this software. If learning about this is of interest to you, stick around and let's get into it. Welcome back to the channel. If you're new here, my name is Gareth, and I am the owner here at Gap Consulting. It's our mission to help you unlock the full potential of no-code tools. One of our favorite no-code tools is Airtable. So in this video, as I mentioned, I'm going to be breaking down my three key tips and takeaways for brand new users in the software. This video is going to be perfect for you if you are just for the first time picking up Airtable and you're coming, let's say, from a spreadsheet mentality or mindset, and you're trying to move into the new wave of technology and software. You're going to love this. This is specifically for you. But before we hop into things, I first want to invite you to join me for some more Airtable training in your email inbox. If you're interested in getting that training from me, I'm going to go into more detail about the things that we talk about here and even include some bonus content. So go ahead and sign up for that at gapconsulting.io/airtable-crash-course. That's my Airtable crash course, be sent to your inbox. But without further ado, let's hop on into my screen and let's imagine that you're coming to Airtable for the first time and it's your job to build a database. Now, you could definitely start with AI. I don't mean to say that the AI is not a great option. If I were starting out today, I'd probably experiment more with this. But here's what I've found over the years that I've worked with Airtable, and then more recently as AI has been introduced to it, we're still seeing that AI isn't quite always making the right choices for us, meaning that it's going to tell us to do things that might not be the right structure. It's really important for you to understand the fundamentals. So that's what I really want you to take away from this. So if you want to go towards AI in the future and have it building your apps, great, but at least do so with an understanding of the basics so that you can start to spot when things aren't quite as they should be. All right, so we're going to build from scratch. This is a great option for anybody who's trying to get familiar with Airtable. And when you come here, you can see that you can import and do all this stuff. Great. This is all really exciting, but here's what I need you to understand first and foremost. This is our number one takeaway. What is a table in Airtable? If you're coming from spreadsheets, you're thinking about every different tab at the bottom as just being a different way of displaying data. But Airtable is really intentional, and you should also be intentional when you're building tables. So a table is the tab that's up here at the top, and a table represents a set of data or a data set. And so let's imagine a scenario where we had books and authors, for example. So in this case, we have every book is written by an author, and these are two different sets of data. And so from that perspective, we would create two different tables, one for each of these things, right? So one of these would be books, and one of these would be authors. We would add a new table, start it from scratch in this case, and this would be authors. So now we have two different tables, each of them representing a data set. The first one is all of the books, let's say in a library. The second one is all of the authors of those books. And of course, in some cases, we would have authors that have authored multiple books. They would connect to multiple books. We're going to show you how to do this in the second tip. The first key takeaway, though, is just understanding what the table is. We're very intentional about building a new table in Airtable or any no-code database. We don't do the same thing that we would do in a spreadsheet. In a spreadsheet, we just create new sheets, kind of willy-nilly. Not so in Airtable, not so in no code. Be very intentional. Think about what the data you're collecting is, and then create that data table. Now, if you want to take this tip a little bit further, let's say you're thinking to yourself, hey, Gareth, I need to look at all of my books that are in the first half of the alphabet, for example. Well, we have views for that. So if you had a bunch of books here, you know, you could list out as many different books. Each record would be a different book. You could add a bunch of lines here and then create new views. And each view can have its own settings, meaning that you can apply filters, groupings, sorts, all kinds of things. So even the type of view is unique to that view. So you could display view data on a calendar. You could do it in a Kanban view. You could do it in a list view. Each different view has its own time and place depending on what data you're looking at and how you want to interpret it, how you want to analyze it. I tend to live in the grid view because it is familiar to me. It looks like and feels like a spreadsheet. So this is where I do a lot of my work, but know that there are a lot of other ways that you can view this data and make it available to your team. So ultimately, the big takeaway here is that we want to be intentional about creating tables only when we have a new set of data, and then we use different views to drill in and see things how we want to, by applying filters, by applying groups, sorting, adding colors, etc. These different settings are unique to each view, and views are a subset of tables. Our number two key takeaway here is to understand the importance of linking tables. Now, we link tables because we want to reduce data redundancy. So for example, you know, if we were in a spreadsheet, we wouldn't have this capability. So we might have a book, let's say The Old Man and the Sea, and we might then, if we were in a spreadsheet, create a column for our authors. Again, this is spreadsheet mentality that we need to overcome. So we do not want to just create a column for authors and use text here. If we did this, we'd have to type in the author's name every time, Hemingway, and this would be very redundant, right? Especially if we store different information about the author, maybe their current email address, obviously not in Hemingway's case, or maybe we would collect information like their birthdays or their date of death, things of that nature. Now, this is all data that's related to the authors, so we would not want to build this text field here. We want to actually, as we've already done, create a second place for our authors to exist, and we're going to connect these two different sets of data together. So let's go ahead and drop these out. In fact, I'll just hide these fields really quickly, and I'm just going to put Ernest Hemingway here. And as I mentioned, we could store other information, for example, his email, his date of birth, etc. But what we care about here is building a link between our data. And so we add a field, and this is where we're going to link to books, and we use a link to another record field. And we can link this table to our other table in Airtable. Now, for Airtable, it has to be in the same base. So we have books and authors both inside of this database that we're currently working in, so we can link to those. You'll see here, if I click on link to another record, I only see those different tables that exist in this database. So if I want to link to books, then I have to ask myself, am I linking to multiple books at a time? That is to say, can one author author multiple books? And of course, the answer is usually yes. So we keep this toggled on. But back here on books, we're now going to see that new field created. The reciprocal of that link also comes into existence. So when we link one thing to another thing, it's linked in both places. And here we need to ask ourselves the same question. Can a book be authored by multiple authors? Generally, we're going to say no here, right? We're only going to have one author for the book. So if that applies to you here, we would toggle this off. And now we can only link to one author when we select here. So we'll only see Hemingway, and we cannot select again. We don't get the option. But over here on authors, if we look at this and we select here, we've already linked to one book, but we could link to more if we had other books written by Hemingway as well. So this is the linked relationship, and wrapping your head around when to use links, when data is interrelated, this is the most amazing thing that Airtable will unlock for you, because this allows, as I mentioned earlier, for you to not have redundant data entry. You just have to put Ernest Hemingway in your database in one place, and now anytime you bring in a new book that he's written, it's a quick, easy way to link. So you don't have to put that data in all over again. You just link to the original piece. So eliminating data redundancy, building the proper linked relationship, and not using text fields if you already have this. So I'm going to get rid of this and just rename this one now. Our linked relationship is authors. This is your second key takeaway as a beginner in no code. Now, our third takeaway is a big one. It's how to share this information once you've properly structured it and built out your database. But before we jump into this, I do want to invite you to stick around until the end, because I'm going to include a fourth bonus for you that is really going to help you unlock even more potential. But our third one, as I said, let's jump into it. It's all about sharing the proper access with the proper folks. So in order to do this, we tend to build interfaces in Airtable. We go over to interfaces and we can start building, and we can either build a form or an interface. And in this case, I want to go with an interface, and I'll call this, let's say librarians. So maybe I want to give and empower my librarians the ability to monitor what's in our library and even add new books and perhaps edit some of the data as well. Well, here we go. I can go in and let's just say I build a list view here at the top, and we'll go with this. There are many different types of interfaces that I don't have time to go into here. Grab that extra training that I mentioned already if you want more in-depth information. But here we're going to say, well, which of our tables are we looking at? So we can only look at one at a time in an interface, but I can bring in more information that's related to those tables. So this is where that second tip, linking everything, it really comes into play. So let's say I want to look at books. Well, here I'm going to get a list of books, and this is the interface builder. When I'm done, it's going to look like this as I preview it. But in here, basically, I can come in and adjust how people see different things and what they can do. So I can say, like, for example, if I want them to open this, I can click here and say, yes, I want to allow that permission. And then when they're in there, I want to give them permission maybe to edit certain things. So maybe I want them to be able to edit this author. Well, I can say right here that you can link and unlink records. This is giving them the capability of editing this information. If I had other fields like email or text or numbers, things of that nature, I could also give them edit capabilities directly in the interface. So this way I can limit what they see. Maybe I don't want them to see authors. In that case, I can hide this field entirely and remove it, right? Just and completely remove it from the interface so that they don't see this. Now, for our example, we're talking about books and authors. It's kind of a silly example, but in a lot of business use cases, you don't want people to see a lot of the data that exists in your database. That's what an interface is for. You can control exactly what they do see, exactly what they can or cannot edit, add, delete, all of that. That's all done here in an interface. Now, when you're ready, you go to publish this interface, and from here, you'll be invited to share it with people. So if you come in, you can just share it automatically here, and it's going to share this entire interface. And there are two very important things to note here. Number one, whatever plan you're on for Airtable, if you're on a paid plan, when you share this interface with somebody, you will now incur a charge for that user. That is a new user that's been added to your account, unless you've already paid for that user every month. So any new person that you add, you're going to be paying for if they have better than read-only. Read-only is free, but commenter or editor access, you're paying for a new license. That's really important to know. Number two big takeaway is that when you share an interface, you share every page in the interface. So what does that look like? Well, if we come in here and we go to edit the interface, you'll see that I've got this page called books. I can add more pages. Let's say I added a calendar. I don't have any calendar type data here, but I could add it. So now I've got books and books too. These are different pages inside of my interface, and I'm sharing at the interface level. So every single page that you've added to an interface, make sure that you want everybody to see. Because when you share this interface, they're going to see all the pages. You cannot conditionally show pages at this point in time with Airtable. Now, we've covered a lot, and I'm thankful to you for sticking around. So here is your big bonus as a new Airtable user. I strongly encourage you to lean into automation. Automation is part of Airtable, or you can go outside of the Airtable environment. Inside of Airtable, though, it's this little button right here. It's going to take you to an entirely new panel or section of the software. And here we can build automations that are either inside of Airtable, like let's say somebody adds a new book, we might want to send an email or update a status or tag somebody. Like there are so many different things that we can do with automation. You can see a few examples here on the side. But basically, every automation has a trigger and actions. So when something happens that you specify, then and only then will the automation run and it will perform whatever actions you've built for it. So this is really important. If you're new to no code, this is going to really, really blow your mind because automation allows for you to, number one, save a ton of time. All this time that you're doing this copy, paste, repetitive work, you get to eliminate that. But the real reason that I love automation, as if that's not enough, is that automation also reduces human error. So now we're not going to have data integrity problems, right? Like we know that our data is solid. It's not dirty. There's no errors in it. It's the same thing every time. The automation will not make a mistake unless you built it to make a mistake. So there you have it. That's a little bonus for you. I hope you absolutely loved this video and take your Airtable learning to the next level. If you haven't already and you got value here, do subscribe to the channel and give us a thumbs up. But most importantly, keep on building.